Welcome to the Jim Baker Show. Coming to you from the village of Morningside, snuggled in the beautiful Ozark Mountains. Today, Jim's special guest, Lieutenant Colonel Robert McGinnis, Tom Horn. I'm Zach Drew, along with the Morningside Band. And now, direct from Gray Street at Morningside, here are your hosts, Jim and Lori Baker!
Hello, everybody. Welcome to Gray Street.
Hi there.
So grateful to have you at our house today.
We are.
And we have an amazing broadcast. You do not want to miss this show.
That's right.
We have the final Pope author here with us today.
That's right. Yes.
Thomas Horn is back. Woo!
You're a
great gift,
yeah.
And you brought a special friend
with you
today. I just got his book last night.
I'm amazing.
A speed reader, but not that fast. I was racing through this book.
Really, truly.
I want to tell you, this book, Never Submit, is perhaps one of the most important books you'll ever read. It's America's time to read this book.
That's right.
Now.
Yes.
Now. Lieutenant Colonel Robert McGinnis is here with us today from the Pentagon. He is a senior strategist at the Pentagon. Worked there. How long have you been in and out of the Pentagon? Have you been in different positions there? I know over the years.
I started in 69 at West Point, and I'm still at the Pentagon, so they're a couple years in between, so it's over 40 years.
Wow. So you work for the Department of the Army. You worked as Inspector General at the Pentagon. What else did you do? Could you give me a little more of your background?
Well, I'm a combat officer, an infantry officer,
wow.
A ranger. I served in 4 infantry divisions, have been... most recently, I run a course for the Army that trains people how to do engagements with armies across the world. I actually train officers and senior civilians on how to do that. And in fact, I'm just about ready to go to Europe to do another one. And then I do a lot of media on the side because I've been an analyst for the last couple of decades.
You're really called upon by the media. I know you're on CNN, you're on Fox.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, we see you.
Yes.
Newspapers, New York Times, U.S. News World Report, Time Magazine. You have written 235 reports on ISIS. So if there's anybody I want to interview today,
yes.
Who is ISIS? What are they doing? What mm-hmm. in the world is going on in our world today?
That's right.
Didn't you report 9/11? And on Fox News or something?
Yeah, I was with several times that day. The last with Bill Bennett and O'Reilly from 11 to 12 o'clock that night. And I had predicted...
That very day,
because I was right there. And I had predicted long before that Osama bin Laden was a threat to the United States because I covered what had happened in Tanzania and Uganda when they attacked our embassies. And also, curiosity as to what was happening with this jihadist movement and what it meant for the United States.
I'm going to really want to ask you a few questions about Paris. It's like, how could this happen to Paris? How does your book, this book, Never Submit, and I'm telling you people, I've just gotten this book. And we'll go into it a little bit more as we go along today. But you can order the book through our show, get it now, and read it.
Yes.
Read it. You don't know where truth is anymore. You need to study. The Bible says study to show
right.
yourself approved.
Amen.
We
Amen.
Need to find out truth because we're
Amen.
In deep, deep, deep trouble.
That's right. Ain't no... One of the things that I'm excited about of having Lieutenant Colonel Robert McGinnis here today is that he has all of this seemingly, inside information, and even being at the Pentagon and being able to filter through what we're seeing on the media and be able to talk to us about the real truth about what's going on. Because even though he's, hardcore in the government, knows this information. He filters it all through a biblical worldview.
Yes. Yeah, thank you, Lord.
Tom, tell us how you met.
Well, actually, we have a mutual friend, Terry James, who is a blind conservative Baptist writer. I've published a lot of books. I think Terry's got 40 or 50 books out there now that's been published over the years. And I knew him, and he came to me one day, and he said, hey, would you be interested in publishing a book? Because he knew that Joel Richardson and I are friends, and that Joel and I had talked quite a bit, and you've had Joel on the program, about the whole apocalyptic mindset behind ISIS, which was important to me. And Terry said, how would you like to publish a guy that works at the Pentagon who happens to agree with this apocalyptic mindset, but who has an insider's, a plan, really, for how to defeat the Islamic State, and this from a guy that this is what he does. He teaches people how to make war, right? And yet, he's a prophecy believer. I'm like, wow, really? I mean, this is a lot of good stuff all rolled into one.
It sure is.
And not just a Christian, a conservative Christian.
Yeah.
Because today, Christianity can mean anything, right?
Sure can.
Yeah.
Sure
wow,
can.
So I jumped at the chance,
That's shocking that you're a conservative Christian. There's such a warfare. America has changed in the last, really, couple decades of extreme change. But it's like God has been outlawed and every other ism has been allowed in. I'm scared for America. I really am. I love America. And I believe America is in deep, deep trouble. What do you see from inside the Pentagon?
Well, I agree with you, Pastor, and in fact, the American people do as well. A new poll says about 83% have no confidence in...
How many?
83%.
83% have no confidence?
Confidence in the direction that we're going with regard to terrorism.
Does anybody hear?
That's right.
Are you all listening to me?
Yes.
No, I mean... Why is nobody listening, but yet everybody's saying the same thing?
Well, they are. As we look around the landscape of the world, we see wars throughout the Middle East. It's just imploding. We see the Europe that we used to think was stable is really beset by terrorism. Russia is loose. The Chinese are becoming very adversarial. There's not a safe place in the world, to include our own borders, which are porous and wide open to jihadists, and we have plenty of reports there. So you look around the world, and you can't help but believe that, if you're a believer in 1 Timothy 3, you see all of that happening in the culture. You believe in Zechariah, you see, Israel is the target. And so as I look geopolitically at what's happening in the world, I look at it through that lens and understand that we are perhaps treading ever closer to an end time scenario. And interestingly, the ISIS people, the Islamists, they say that in their own writings. I look at Dabiq, which of course is their glossy magazine. And just this past week, I was looking at it. And they talk about the end times. They talk about hating everybody but them. And their own particular slice of Islam, which is rather conservative, to say the least. And I look at what our president is doing. It seems like he's running in opposite direction that the American people want us to go.
Yes.
We feel abandoned in terms of our own personal security, and that's why the polls are beginning to reflect what the American people believe, and that is that this man is not looking out for our best interests.
No.
And that's unfortunate, because we need a commander-in-chief.
That's right. There it is.
And I think as Christians, we're told to respect our leaders. We're told to pray for our leaders.
Yes.
And, we need to pray for our president like we've never prayed before.
Amen.
But it's so heartbreaking, because America is really divided. But yet more and more, they're screaming out. They're worried about Paris. Can we talk a little bit about Paris today and what's happened over in Paris? And then in Belgium, Brussels is an amazing city. Have you ever been there? It's a beautiful city. I flew there from India one time from the worst floods in history, and then I land at this beautiful, shiny airport in Brussels, and it was such a contrast. And they've closed, as we're taping this program, they have been closed. The city has been closed for days. What in the... Come on now. There's got to be more that they know that they're not telling us, to close down Brussels, Belgium, to Brussels in Belgium, to close it all down.
That's
for
right.
Weeks now almost. It's going into a second week, I think.
Yeah, well, the article right here, it says, Brussels will remain at the highest possible alert level. It says, with schools, universities, and metros closed over a serious...
because they've lost control of their culture. You know, you've had, for instance, in Brussels or in Belgium, you've had about 700 people that have gone to Syria, learned how to kill, and many have come back. In France alone, you had 1,800 that have gone to Syria. You know, 180 have come back, and there are a bunch of them that are still loose. You also have within those countries, you know, I call it a Dalmatian effect. You have in the industrial areas of Lyon and Paris and Marseille, these ghettos of people that have come in there as legal refugees, but they failed to totally assimilate. That's important because when ISIS comes in and recruits, they recruit amongst the dissatisfied people, the people that want a different purpose, that don't like the West. And so they raised up five of those killers the other night in Paris, were all French nationals. And of course, the ringleader appears to have been a Frenchman who was in Syria, who was controlling things from Raqqa. So you've got this happening across Europe. It's been going on for a couple of decades, and it's getting very, very bad.
You say it's been going on for several decades. When I read Joel's book,
Joel Richardson's book, yes.
I mean, it was such a shock to my system.
Right.
I didn't put it down like your
right.
book.
Yes.
I got my hands on it, and I had to go to sleep because I have to do a show, and you get old, you got to sleep once in a while. But I read Joel's. You read
yeah.
it, too.
Oh, it was
shocking.
If you haven't read it, you need to read this, too.
What I thought was coming someday is already here. We've been infiltrated. You know, the communists used to have an agenda that they said they would destroy America from within. And it looks like it's not the communist, but it looks like there's another group that's here already. Do you think even ISIS is inside of our country?
Oh, of course. There are 1,000 investigations the FBI is doing right now. We have the likes of the Muslim Brotherhood who's made it very clear their intent is to take over as much as they can. You know, I talked to a gentleman the other day who has interviewed hundreds of Al-Qaeda and Islamists in the Middle East. And he said, Bob, you know, they don't just want to kill us. They want to take over our children. What they want to do is come in and take over the schools. And if you look at the investment of the radical Saudi Arabian government, they're in our prisons. They're in our schools. They run the teachers' colleges, in many cases, to their endowments and the like. This is what they're thinking long term. So we have to recognize that, yes, we have a very serious terrorist threat. We have ISIS amongst us. My own son-in-law, a sergeant in our local police department, went into a home. The parents didn't know. The son had an ISIS flag on the wall. He had been recruiting for ISIS and sent some of his friends to Syria. That's the sort of thing that Americans have to wake up and recognize that
yes.
we have a real threat here.
Yes, we do.
Wow.
It's very serious. Wow.
What happened in Paris? How could this happen? We're told that they have the best security. Do they have a better infrastructure for defending their own country than we do?
No, not any better.
I didn't think so.
You know, their borders were wide open because of the Schengen Agreement, which basically says you don't need a passport to go from one country to another. So there's a flow of people back and forth. That Syrian that was in that group, you know, he came and went to Syria, and apparently they didn't know in Paris that this happened. They do have a lot of police. They have a lot of surveillance cameras. They have reasonably good intelligence, but it failed. It totally failed. You know, when you talk about six targets simultaneously, they had practiced maybe a couple targets simultaneously, but six just, you know, blew their minds in terms of security. You know, in America, You know, we've done similar things. We've increased threefold our intelligence investment. We've increased a host of other things, certainly made our borders tighter. You know, our no-flies list, it was only 12 or 19 back in 2001. Today, it's 48,000 and growing. You know, the vulnerability that we have, though, and most of the non-American jihadists that have come here have come through the visa program. The visa program allowed the shoe bomber to come in, allowed the underwear bomber to come in, and allows a lot of people. In fact, in countries like Germany, known about 5,000 jihadists that could get on an airplane today and not be stopped because of our visa program and come to America and do something. We have some evidence that has happened in the past. We need to get really serious about this. In fact, the Canadians, you know, interestingly, they said they're going to welcome 25,000 Syrians very shortly. You know, our president says 10,000, which is far too many, but they're talking about 25,000. And given the porous border we have with Canada, you know, you have to wonder, how many people are going to come south? And we already have a problem with people coming north. Just the other day, we stopped 9 trying to come into our southern border and then 5 down in Honduras. So there is a very serious border issue.
I hear every day on the news our leaders saying there is no problem. We have no evidence. You'll hear one person say there's no evidence that there's anyone inside of our country or anyone planning anything. Yet in their magazines they say we plan to destroy America. The very first statement after Paris, what was it, Lori? You remember?
One of the first ones I heard was that they were coming for, of course, Washington, D.C., and they wanted to taste American blood because there was no, that was the best blood
but
that they could taste.
It's in the social media. It's everywhere. How can our leaders keep telling us there's no sign that there's any danger in America? Yet you're telling me ISIS is in America.
They're lying to you.
Now, is it just you that says that they're lying to us, or is there other people with you at the Pentagon that understand that the lies that take place?
Well, if you'd listen to the former director of the Defense Intelligence Agency, he was on Fox last night, and I know him. He said, look, we've been telling the White House for years that this is a growing threat. Even Dianne Feinstein, who is no Republican,
yeah.
You know, she said on the news the other day that she reads the intelligence every day and
That's
says
right.
The problem is growing. It's getting much worse. You know, what they want to do, they're changing the dynamics of how they conduct operations. They use homegrown terrorists, but then they use some of these returning jihadists that have the killing skills, and then they have the general operation out of overseas, out of Syria or elsewhere. And so those three coming together is a very volatile mix, and that's what happened in Paris. They were able to, in a very sophisticated fashion, hit 6 targets simultaneously for about $2,000 investment. They made the suicide bombs out of hydrogen peroxide, which is the same problem we've had in this country. And that's the reason you can't take fluids on airplanes these days, because you take simple Clorox, basically, and make it into an explosive device. And, of course, acquiring the weapons, they got the weapons mostly from the Balkans. It was not one's blood. And that's why I went and Never Submit, I have a chapter, a couple chapters on what Islam teaches.
Yes.
You have to understand that these people are sealed with hatred, and they're willing to die for their cause, and they will die whether we like it or not. They're going to die killing us if given the opportunity. I was on CNN with Chris Cuomo the other day on live, and somebody who had just been at that theater where they were methodically going down, shot by shot by shot, killing those people. And this guy said, these people were so cool. The killers, they were all dressed up alike. They said, you know, one very simple thing. So Allahu Akbar, God is great. We're doing this because of what you did in Syria. And so methodically, one after another. I've been in Iraq where Saddam Hussein buried thousands of people, and I saw the hands you know, cuffed behind their head or behind their, and a shot in their skull, a single bullet shot. Now, that's what they do. And they want to bring that here. They do it all over Syria and Iraq. And we have to recognize that same barbarism that they evidence. They want to bring it here. And we have to be careful. Yes.
Do we have holes in our system that they can come through?
Well, they pry, and all we have to do is be wrong 1% of the time, and we're vulnerable. And it only took, what, 8 people?
That's right.
So how hard is it to get 8 people? You know, our borders, we're about 40 to 50% effective at stopping the flow of people. Are people trying to get into our southwest borders? Are people flying in that shouldn't fly in? Are they coming from the north? Of course they are. And are they amongst us? Yes, they are. So the elements are there.
Okay, millions are coming across our south borders. Millions over the years.
Oh,
is that
true,
right?
True.
So it's not possible some of our enemies kind of sneak in with the Hispanic people coming across the border?
In May of this year, Dabiq, the ISIS magazine, talked about a plan that they had. And then you can read it. It's online. It's not very easy reading, by the way. It's in English, but it's not very good English. They talked about acquiring basically radioactive material. They would then ship this radioactive material to their friends in Libya. Of course, there's that civil war country. ISIS has part of it. They would then use the drug cartels operating out of Nigeria to ship it over to Colombia, and then, of course, up through our porous border aboard vehicles. And then they would plant it in certain places. Now, you know, that may be seem outlandish, but then on the 7th of October of this year, the FBI, there were all sorts of not drug gangs, but illegal gangs that were trying to sell radioactive material to, you know, groups like ISIS. Do they want to do that? Yes, they do want to do that. The other day, the president of France, Hollande, you know, said, you know, we're concerned about a biological and a chemical attack. Now, of course, we've seen plenty of chemicals used in Syria, but it's the radiological, even the hydrogen peroxide bomb or plastic explosive in the city like Washington, D.C. Mm-hmm. It would become a contaminated place for ever.
Yeah. What about one thing that I've wondered about is, what about an airplane and you turn it into aerosol, like a crop duster?
Oh,
and
yeah.
You fly over a major metropolitan area with dirty materials, radioactive materials.
Yeah, it's interesting. Just this morning, they were talking about a jet that ISIS was talking about using as a suicide bomb. I don't know. It's a little, because we have this nice ocean between us and them. Would they like to do that? Of course. You know, I've said many times, they spend 30 hours a day, and that's an exaggeration, I understand, 30 hours a day trying to figure out how to kill us. And if you've ever, you know, I've been to Guantanamo, and I've watched them interrogate jihadists, Al-Qaeda, some of the most fierce people. I've talked to the investigators, the interrogators. These people truly do hate us. They hate what we represent. And they do believe that they should dominate the world. And unfortunately, if you don't remove them, they will continue to do this. And the more power and the longer we stay back, like our president has allowed us to stay back and allow this to metastasize across a very large area of the world, the more serious this becomes. And today, I think we're beginning to, you know, see the ramifications, a tsunami of young men flooding all over Western Europe. Terrorism is on the rise. You know, the fear amongst all Westerners is high. You know, the governments in the Middle East just can't contain this. You know, so, you know, that, of course, invites the likes of Russia in. You know, you could make a pretty good case here, Pastor, that, you know, these do look like the end times.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. And, you know, one of the things that's unfortunate is that seemingly the Islamic community is more end times minded than the Christian community is. Mm-hmm. They're more apocalyptic minded than we are, mm-hmm. in a lot of the sense. And you know, it's the thing is that if we understood what the Word of God actually said about the end times, if we knew the Word of God like the back of our hand, like Christians should, we'd understand if we just simply just looked upon the world scene that we have. If you understand Islamic eschatology and their apocalyptic mindset, you understand why they're doing the things they do. Well, why would these Islamic extremists, why would they want to infiltrate the United States? Why wouldn't they just be satisfied with staying in the Middle East? Because with their apocalyptic mindset, mm-hmm. you understand, according to their end times thoughts, their eschatology, mm-hmm. that they want to infiltrate the rest of the world to set up a one world global caliphate.
Right.
And you understand, well, that's why they don't just want to stay in the Middle East, because they believe it's so close to the end, they're infiltrating right now as we speak.
Yeah. That's right.
Yeah, and Zach, that's partly what makes them so dangerous, is that we as Christians, we observe prophecy. We believe prophecy will happen. It was predicted. The end times will unfold, and we observe it. But we don't make it happen, right?
Right.
We just observe it. Where in the Sunni Islamic belief, it's their responsibility to initiate Armageddon. And that's why they're driven to do what they do. They all
want us to attack them.
Oh, yeah. That's why they're killing people, yeah. and boiling them and burning them and beheading them. They're trying
that?
To agitate the
they're
world.
They're not trying to save their own hides. We're trying to save our own hides. They're not. They want us to attack them.
Right.
And if they die, they go to a heaven or someplace.
They have 7 levels of heaven and 7 levels of hell. I don't understand that, but whatever.
I mean, this is a war. I believe, I've had so many guests say they believe we're in the Third World War.
Yes.
And what does a lieutenant colonel say about war? I'm just going to tell you what I think, so I don't want to embarrass you, but I just think this is the Third World War. I think it's a different kind of war, but it's worldwide. The enemy has already infiltrated our country, and it's done it all over the world. The Christians are being beheaded in the Middle East. They're being killed, and most churches do not want to hear it. They don't even want to hear. I mean, I have never had such warfare of people upset because the guest I bring on.
It's true.
Because they don't want to hear. They want somebody to come on and tell you how to make some more money. And I want to tell you something. All that money you pile in the bank, one of these days, if these things happen, your money's gone.
That's right.
I mean, Ted Koppel wrote a book. You know Ted, I'm sure. And it's called Lights Out. Do you know about the grid? Have you studied the grid? What do you think is going? He says, he doesn't even say it's going to happen, except, I mean, he says it's absolutely going to happen. He doesn't say he thinks it's going to happen. He says this will happen if we don't do something about it. Yeah. And he said the cyber,
that's right.
He feels, and we've studied the bombs, the EMP bombs, and we've studied the solar and the sun. And then Ted Koppel comes out and talks about, there's people into our grid system right now.
That's right.
Do you have any information about that?
What I can talk about it, I will. Cyber is a very serious threat. The federal government is hit every day by millions of cyber attacks.
Millions?
Millions. Oh, yes. I can tell when my computers there at the Pentagon slow down that the Chinese have been very happy that day. and we're constant. Shutting down of operations across the government. But the infrastructure, of course, we're so connected, so interconnected electronically that, you know, we are very vulnerable to, you know, the likes of EMP or whatever. When Zach was talking about what the Sunnis and what Tom talked about, I think of what the Shia have been saying. You know, you've got the way in which they bring back their Mahdi, their Messiah, is by the elimination of the United States and Israel.
Right.
And the Ayatollah Ali Khamenei has made it very clear in many statements, you know, we want to destroy them. Death to America. You know, and even in the wake of this giveaway nuclear program that our president has done, which has backfired, I think, already, and it's going to get even worse, that they are developing capabilities that, you know, ISIS is very bad. Iran is very, very bad. And they're kind of a secret sort of thing. You know, I was speaking at a conference a month ago, and after I spoke, this man who was from Iran came up, and he said, "You're 100% right. You know exactly what you're talking about. These people are very, very dangerous." Now, this man had been in prison in Tehran for 18 months, and God gave him the dream. And he said, "You're going to get out." And he did. And now he's in exile in the West. And he's doing everything he can to warn the American people, the people in North America, about that threat. So, yes, ISIS is the immediate threat. Iran is a very serious threat. And, of course, we face others that are just, you know, for years I wrote about China. For years I've written about Russia. I've been to Russia, been to China. These are very, very tenuous times. And unfortunately, as I indicate, Pastor, and never submit, I talk about what happens in the National Security Council. I've got friends that go over there. They won't let me because of my conservative views. But I have friends that have tried to communicate to these people, and they'll go in there, and these young people who really have no background to do the things they do will say, "No, we can't do that." Or they're sycophants when the president shows up and asks them how things are happening. You know, they're making critical decisions. You know, we spent $1 trillion and 4,000 American lives in a place called Iraq. And now we continue to spend in places like Afghanistan and now soon in Syria. You know, we need adult leadership, and yet we don't have it at our National Security Council. Yet they have good intelligence, and occasionally we actually have some good people in the Pentagon. Now, I'm friends with a lot of the top generals. I went to school with the very senior people. And unfortunately, I've been incredibly disappointed that they bought into the political establishment. They bought in thinking that they're more important and their image is more important than the interests of the American people. And so I felt abandoned by my own friends, people that were in positions of authority. I had a four-star Marine tell me, you know, years ago, he said, "Bob, the reason I wouldn't throw my stars on the president's desk is because, you know, I didn't think anyone else could do the job." Well, I didn't buy that. And I don't buy it today. And yet we have plenty of people in very senior positions making life and death decisions for our security in this country, and they've abandoned us.
Yeah.
Well, and as a layperson, of course, I have no experience whatsoever in military strategy or border control or any of that other stuff. But one of the things that's concerned me, I think we're actually at greater risk right now of an attack, like Paris, maybe something much worse, in the United States than we ever have been before. And part of that is because of our border policy. Part of it's because for at least 7 years we've had an absence of executive leadership. It's even been hostile to good intelligence. So a lot of the guys you're working with, they give the government good intelligence, but they only find hostility. And, you know, Hillary Clinton saying Muslims have nothing whatsoever to do with terrorism and that kind of crazy apologetic that's coming. And here's what I think, Jim. I'm just jumping in here, and then I'll shut up.
No,
just stay in the pool. We want you swimming.
But stay in the pool, okay?
Yes, please.
I think that between now and the presidential election might be one of the most critical times in American history, because the people who are coming across our borders, and I saw there was American Enterprise Institute, I was trying to remember the name, published a report yesterday. They're polling the people the refugees as they're coming across the border, and 13% of them are sympathetic to ISIS. 13%. And of course, maybe they're being conservative, but maybe not everybody would admit that
That's
they're coming
right
into the country. So you might have 2 out of 10 that are coming here. These are people who would work with ISIS against the United States, and they're coming across our borders. But they've got to know that between now and the coming election in 1 year from now is their best window of opportunity, because talk about sympathies, they're getting it from the federal level on down. But you might get what's everybody in the GOP right now saying? They're saying, "Elect me, and the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to close the borders and put these people on trains back to their countries." And so I think that why that's critical is it might mean that there's a thinking in the terror communities that this is their best time between now and the election to do something.
We will be right back after this special message.
We're already in the Third World War. It's actually underway right now.
Really?
Yeah. China and Russia's waging a financial war against the U.S. dollar. There are cyber wars that are taking place. There are mysterious explosions taking place in certain countries, including China. Massive explosions where chemical plants are blowing up.
Number one, I believe a great shaking is coming, great shaking that will change things, affecting America financially, economically, and more than that, and will affect the world, but a change of history.
And he says, you guys know how to interpret the signs of the weather. And then he rebuked him, and he said, but you don't know how to interpret the signs of the times. Jesus expects his followers to read the Bible and pay attention to the evening news.
Whether it's a disaster, an economic collapse, or wars, your life can change in an instant. You need to get prepared now. That is why you need to call 1-888-988-1588 and order our Year for You, Year for Two, or Time of Trouble offer. For as little as a donation of $600 or more to the ministry, you can receive 1,096 servings of food that will last one person a full year. In each of these offers, you will receive buttermilk pancakes, maple brown sugar oatmeal, chocolate pudding, whey milk, creamy chicken and rice, hearty vegetable chicken, creamy potato soup, creamy stroganoff, fettuccine alfredo, Italiano marinara, black bean burger, chicken noodle soup, corn chowder, macaroni and cheese, banana chips, instant white rice, instant mashed potatoes. The Year for Two offer is available for a donation of $1,100 or more to the ministry. This offer comes with 2,192 servings of food and comes in 8 buckets. For a donation of $3,500 or more to the ministry, you can receive our Time of Trouble offer. This offer comes with 7,672 servings of food. Please order your food today. You can donate to this ministry by calling 1-888-988-1588 or go online to jimbakershow.com. You can also write to Jim Baker at P.O. Box 7330, Branson, Missouri 65615. Thank you for your continued prayers and support that helps keep us broadcasting around the world.
Could we do a Baker's Dozen on the book?
Yes, we sure can.
Never submit book.
Yes, that's right. And you can get 13 at Baker's Dozen for a donation of $130 to the ministry.
That's amazing. That boils down?
Yeah, $10 a book.
Incredible.
Yes.
That's half
retail. That's right.
You can get one book for a gift of $20, but if you get the Baker's Dozen, they're down to a $10.
That's right.
Give them I'm serious. Get strong. Make Christmas count.
Is that what we said? That's it. This year.
Come on.
Make Christmas count is the theme.
You know what?
Of this Christmas.
Lori and I have been talking over because we love Christmas, but we almost have a love-hate relationship right now with Christmas because we have a big family.
Yes.
Do you know what it's like to have to buy presents for everybody, try to figure out the right one, the good ones?
Insanity is what it is.
And then you get it done, and people know, I don't remember what I got last year.
Exactly. We're not doing that this year.
We're giving survival buckets
whether you guys
to our kids.
Or not.
Our kids work behind the scenes. The Christmas bucket.
Yeah, the Christmas variety bucket.
Kept, they know.
It's like Merry Christmas.
The thing of it is, every time I give them one and they got it stacked at their house, that's one less they're going to come to my house and get.
That's right.
If things get bad.
So,
a gift of $100, we're sending
the Christmas
variety
bucket.
This is about a month and a half of food.
Yeah.
It's the best.
That's
the best in packets.
18 different foods and drinks in there.
20-year shelf life.
That's right. 51 days of food. Yeah. As for a donation of only $100 to the ministry. And remember that for every $1,000 you donate to the ministry, you help sponsor the Prayer Mountain Chapel that's being built right now. Mm-hmm. And you get your name for every $1,000 on the Eternal Prayer Wall. So if you donate for 10 of these buckets, you become a Prayer Mountain Chapel sponsor.
If I just had 100 people give $1,000, just give a check for $1,000, We could start the chapel before Christmas, and it's an amazing, amazing product, and that's what I felt led to build the chapel out of.
Right. Which
my first home is almost done that we're building, mm-hmm. which God showed me like 25 years ago I would build these dome mm-hmm. houses in the last days, mm-hmm. and they really are amazing.
Yeah.
And in fact, I'm so in love with the model mm-hmm. that I'd like to get it myself.
Really?
But it's too expensive
news to
for me.
Once again, like I said, I found out half of my life
not
on
done.
The
that,
show.
That unit, that's all. It's got some more work to do on it. It's mm-hmm. going to have a sunroom or a mm-hmm. greenhouse on the side where you can, you know, sit out on your green porch, your green room mm-hmm. with plants in it. You can have
like
you can grow stuff
sunroom.
In the winter,
mm-hmm.
but you can be warm out there in the mm-hmm. middle, and it's an amazing. That's the bathroom in the side of the mountain.
Yeah, you have to have vision.
That's
to
where
see
the commode
like
sits. There's the chandeliers going into
like
the
a
dome.
Spa. It's like a spa.
And it is an amazing product. It has a fireplace. Every dome house has either a fireplace or
a wood burning stove.
A wood burning stove mm-hmm. for any emergencies. Mm-hmm. They stay so cool. They're like caverns and
right.
caves. So, and there's the kitchen going in right now. Wait till you see it done. Mm-hmm. And it's just an amazing house. It's just an amazing place. And it's fireproof. People have been through forest fires in California in the dome house.
That's
and just
right.
go inside and the fire went on by.
I understand. I heard that the kids, or the students, some of the students went up with you to Prayer Mountain. So I believe it must be, I wasn't there, so I'm looking to see it too. It must be Jim Baker with some of our media students up on Prayer Mountain.
It's just a few days before Christmas. Theron gave me his phone with Christmas music. And so today we've been laying out a more defined circle where the prayer dome will go here on Prayer Mountain. And I want to thank all of you that have been supporting Prayer Mountain. And we're believing God by Christmas that we will be able to begin building the chapel here on Prayer Mountain. As you look around here, we've been tying ribbons. It's amazing. All we could find was red ribbon, and we tied these red ribbons to mark the exact spot for the chapel. And it's like we're decorating Prayer Mountain for Christmas in honor of Jesus. And it has really been amazing being up here and looking out right now. In fact, as I look forward there, I can see the water tower here at Morningside, and I can see the big bell tower on top of Gray Street there and all the colorful buildings. It's really quite a sight from this Prayer Mountain area. And hearing this Christmas music in the background has really put me in the Christmas mood. But I want to thank you again and pray that some of you will join and say, we're going to place our family name as an act of praise here at Christmas time. We're going to give a Christmas gift to God, a chapel that people can come to 24 hours a day here. It is a ways up. It's about a mile drive to get up here to Prayer Mountain, but it'll be worth the drive. And it is a beautiful, beautiful, serene, quiet spot here in the Ozark Mountains, a beautiful place here at Morningside. I'm going to go back to our regular program right now, but I want to say again, Merry Christmas from Prayer Mountain. My first Merry Christmas from Prayer Mountain. God loves you. We love you. We're so excited when we can all gather here on Prayer Mountain. It won't be long if you stand with us. God loves you. Oh, he really does. The thing that I want to tell people watching the show today is we have, for a few more days, we have put together the biggest and the best per serving offer of food we have ever offered. This is an amazing, amazing offer.
That's right. It's called the Peace of Mind offer. And you have the basic...
That must be Lori's offer.
Yeah, yes. She actually created the name.
I love the name.
And honestly, if you order this order, it's the 7 year of food.
Right.
All in packets.
Yes.
The best food
That's
we have.
Right.
These are the big master buckets.
Yes, those
buckets
are the bulk.
Here.
That's right.
This is the, like, the rolled oats and the wheat and all the sugar and all this, everything amazing
right.
for bulk food.
Yes.
That's almost 8 years, isn't it?
Yes, yes. It's well over 7 years of food right here, the bulk buckets.
Yeah.
And it's 28 buckets of bulk food.
Yeah.
And it also comes with all the buckets that are behind me right now.
Yeah, and this
That's
is
right.
7 years.
Yes.
And all of this is the best food there is. That's Joseph's Storehouse.
That's the bulk.
The big.
Yes.
I mean, anybody that feels like we might go through something.
Yeah.
This is like going to your own store. This is where you go. You got bananas. You know, you think bananas grow in the supermarket. They don't. They grow down south. And potatoes and all of the amazing food in bulk.
Yes. Amen.
The milk bucket is 55 gallons in one of the powdered buckets.
That's right.
55 gallons
That's
of
right.
milk. And if you like skim milk, you can end up with 100 and some gallons of milk if you want to water it down to what they do for skim milk. But these are amazing. If you're ever going to help yourself, when the event that these men on today's broadcast comes about.
Yes.
I mean, you got learned scholars saying there's going to be an attack on America.
That's right.
You've got a man who... one of the top journalists of all time saying there's going to be a time when the power grid is going down and they're already planning it.
That's right. And not that they're not only capable of hacking into our power grid. Ted Koppel warns that currently, as you and I sit here, they are currently, China and Russia are sitting in our grid, and he warns that even Iran is on the verge of being able to just sit in the grid and be able to turn off whenever they would like to.
Well, did you hear what the colonel said? He works in the Pentagon. This is one of our great leaders. I hope he serves in our government forever.
Yes.
You know,
wow.
Till he's 120.
Yeah. Right.
But what did he say? Daily. I'm sure I didn't hear him right.
No, he said millions.
He did, because he said every day in the Pentagon, they're hacking into the systems over a million times in a day. Millions of times. That's insane.
Yes.
He said they hack so much, he can tell when the computers at the Pentagon slow down. They've already hacked into our grid, according to the experts.
Right.
That's right.
It will be a cyber war on our grid that Ted Koppel says will bring it down. So why wouldn't you have food?
That's right.
I don't get what's going on. I don't get people saying, don't prepare. If there's 1% chance that maybe I heard from God, I would be prepared. And I am prepared. Because God has never lied to me. God has never told me anything that did not come to pass.
That's right.
Everything is coming to pass that he ever told me about. And so today, the best thing that I can say for someone who's not prepared, pray about, instead of doing a wasteful Christmas,
right.
order, you know, the peace of mind offer get enough food for how many years?
It's a total of 14 years and 8 months of food.
14 years and 8 months.
Yeah, it boils down to 28 cents a serving.
So again, this is the bulk food over here, but then over here we have, and we've
yes.
all taken, and we have been the taste testers here.
Yeah.
We have tasted yeah. every single one of these foods, and they come in the individual packets inside the buckets. And again, I say it over and over and over, but Rick Joyner said years ago, you better have something to barter with.
That's right.
Yeah. This makes an amazing bartering tool.
Yeah.
And these buckets, and in each of the buckets is actually 90 days of food with 18 different recipes within
yeah.
the buckets.
Well, Lori has one of the marinara.
Oh, you're there? That's your favorite.
Right there.
There it
now,
is.
Now, listen to me. If you have this, it's so saucy.
So there you go.
Yeah, you love your sauce.
Yes. When I go to get spaghetti in a restaurant, I want a little noodles with my sauce.
That's right.
Mostly sauce, huh?
I hate, you know,
yes.
Jibber, forgive me, you guys up in Alaska. But when I first went to Alaska, I was on the Alcan Highway, and I stopped at a restaurant. I said I wanted spaghetti. You know what I got? A plate of spaghetti, no sauce.
Just the noodles.
Just the noodles. I don't know if they still do that in Alaska or not, but
Joe,
it was.
Joe, do they still do that, Giovanna, in Alaska?
Not
she
at her house, enough. Right?
Your mom and dad make sure you
so
eat.
So this has so much sauce in it. So I mean, if you're crazy about Italian food and you have your whole pile of these, you could take the rice over here. You can take some of the rice and put this with it, and you've got tremendous Italian dish,
right?
Full of fiber and full of energy for you to live on. And so between these two deals, we've never put them together before.
No.
And the food companies that are working with us, mm-hmm. these are the best.
Right.
And by the way, I was going to tell it on the show again today. Two of the biggest food companies, two of them, both have reported to us and others that the government has contacted them, that there's something coming, mm-hmm. and they let them know they wanted an inventory of all their food in their factory.
That's right.
And that could be seized at any time.
And it give any moment's notice.
Now, I couldn't say that if that wasn't true. We verified it. We verified with the owners of the companies. And people are going off, flipping off, just flipping. Just, oh, who cares? Who cares? You're going to care when the food's gone. You say, oh, Jim, I don't believe that. You're telling Jesus that he's a liar? Jesus said there's coming a time when there will be no food to eat. I believe it so much that I've dedicated my life to getting people ready, because I believe we're going to see millions of souls saved if we're alive to do it.
Amen.
But Pastor, we're going to have to be live. Is that right?
And Pastor Jim, you talk about what are you going to do with 14 years and 18 months, 8 months, 14 years, 8 months of food.
Mm-hmm.
But Lori, you know, I've seen your family.
Yes.
Sasha, we're all family here.
Yes.
And people are going to keep coming. They're going to keep coming, and they're going to look to you to be that lighthouse. And it's what are you going to do when you have that opportunity? It is like Lori's always said, is, you know, feed them and then feed into them. So
that's
you,
right.
you got to have it. And this is the best opportunity I've ever seen us be able to put together, because the folks, our supplier, has partnered with us on a temporary basis
yeah.
to do this now, because they see what's going on in the world and they want to help now.
And it's temporary, people.
It is.
Before God, it's temporary. And when this, they've prepared this food,
mm-hmm.
we can ship this tomorrow. I mean,
right.
immediately.
Oh, yes,
it's shipping.
Yes,
they're
it's
shipping.
Shipping now.
Right now.
Yeah,
right
just
now.
Shipping now.
So yes.
the thing of it is, when it's gone, It's gone, and it has to go back to the normal prices. And what do they save on this? Do you have any idea how much?
Yes, I do. Yeah, well, the Peace of Mind offer, it has a retail value of over $10,800. So it's actually a savings of $6,325.
That's crazy.
Yes. One.
Wow.
This is probably the biggest offer we'll ever offer. And how many, how much money do they save?
They save a total of $6,325.
And so it comes to how much per serving then?
28 cents a serving, 14 years and 8 months of food for a donation.
28 cents a serving? You can't get a McDonald's hamburger the way we used to get a McDonald's hamburger. I think they were 15 cents when I was born or something. Not when I was born, but when I was a kid, though. You know, is this breaking news?
Breaking news right now.
Another hostage situation in North France. Several have suffered gunshot wounds. It's just breaking news, so we don't have the information. But this is, they don't know if it's connected to the one on November 13th or not, but it's just breaking news right now. And the hostages were taken, gunshots fired. The neighborhood has been cordoned off, and a bank director and his family may have been taken as hostages. And so it's happening, people, all over the world. And if we don't start having compassion in our hearts.
That's right.
For the millions of Christians.
That's right, Jim.
These Christians in Africa that were just shot and killed, many of them in a luxury hotel, they were asked to quote a verse from the Quran.
That's right.
And those who couldn't, bam, they shot their brains out.
That's right.
Do you people really believe nothing's going on?
Hmm.
If a crisis takes place and the food's gone, there's no time to get ready. There's no stores will be open. Nothing will be there. But to have this, with inflation alone, you could just sell it to your neighbors. It works as a trade. To have these packets, especially Lori had one of them here, that would be like having $100 bill or more. It'd be priceless, really.
That's
so
right.
Today, those who will say, Jim, I really want to be ready, and those who say, Jim, I want to give something anyway.
Right.
You know, people give to church.
Yes.
You could give this gift. What is it total now?
It's a total of a $4,500 donation.
For all of it.
For everything.
That's a saving of over $6,000.
Yes. And we're actually going to be throwing in a Bible bucket with that as well.
Oh, yeah. That's
oh, yeah.
Awesome.
Might as well throw something else in.
Yeah.
And the Word of God.
What a savings. But you're giving to the work of the Lord.
Yes.
And I don't even know how we do it, except the food company is as passionate about getting people ready
yes,
as we are.
That's it.
Remember that God loves you. He really does. Call 1-888-988-1588 or write us at Post Office Box 7330, Branson, Missouri 65615.
Or go to our website, jimbakershow.com.
Bye-bye for today. God loves you. He really does. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. We love you.
Thank you for watching today's broadcast. You can donate to this ministry by calling 1-888-988-1588 or write to Jim Baker at P.O. Box 7330, Branson, Missouri 65615. Thank you for your continued prayers and support that helps keep us broadcasting around the world.
Airplanes these days, because you take simple Clorox basically and make it into an explosive device. And of course, acquiring the weapons, they got the weapons mostly from the Balkans. It was not one's blood. And that's why I went and never submit. I have a couple chapters on what Islam teaches.
Yes.
You have to understand that these people are sealed with hatred. And they're willing to die for their cause. And they will die whether we like it or not. They're going to die killing us if given the opportunity. I was on CNN with Chris Cuomo the other day on live. And somebody who had just been at that theater where they were methodically going down shot by shot by shot, killing those people. And this guy said, these people were so cool. They, the killers. They were all dressed up alike. They said, you know, one very simple thing. So Allahu Akbar, God is great. We're doing this because of what you did in Syria. And so methodically, one after another. And I've been in Iraq where where Saddam Hussein buried thousands of people, and I saw the hands, you know, cuffed behind their head or behind their, and a shot in their skull, a single bullet shot. Now, that's what they do. And they want to bring that here. They do it all over Syria and Iraq. And we have to recognize that same barbarism that they evidence. They want to bring it here. And we have to be careful. Yes.
Do we have holes in our system that they can come through?
Well, they pry, and all we have to do is be wrong 1% of the time, and we're vulnerable. And it only took, what, 8 people?
That's right.
So how hard is it to get 8 people? You know, our borders, we're about 40 to 50% effective at stopping the flow of people. Are people trying to get into our southwest borders? Are people flying in that shouldn't fly in? Are they coming from the north? Of course they are. And are they amongst us? Yes, they are. So the elements are there.
Okay, millions are coming across our south borders. Millions over the years.
Oh,
is that
true,
right?
True.
So it's not possible some of our enemies kind of sneak in with the Hispanic people coming across the border?
In May of this year, Dabiq, the ISIS magazine, talked about a plan that they had. And then you can read it. It's online. It's not very easy reading, by the way. It's in English, but it's not very good English. They talked about acquiring basically radioactive material. They would then ship this radioactive material to their friends in Libya. Of course, there's that civil war country. ISIS has part of it. They would then use the drug cartels operating out of Nigeria to ship it over to Colombia, and then, of course, up through our porous border aboard vehicles. And then they would plant it in certain places. Now, you know, that may be seem outlandish, but then on the 7th of October of this year, the FBI, there were all sorts of not drug gangs, but illegal gangs that were trying to sell radioactive material to, you know, groups like ISIS. Do they want to do that? Yes, they do want to do that. The other day, the president of France, Hollande, you know, said, you know, we're concerned about a biological and a chemical attack. Now, of course, we've seen plenty of chemicals used in Syria, but it's the radiological, even hydrogen peroxide bomb or plastic explosive in the city like Washington, D.C. Mm-hmm. It would become a contaminated place for ever.
Yeah. What about one thing that I've wondered about is, what about an airplane and you turn it into aerosol, like a crop duster?
Oh, yeah.
You fly over a major metropolitan area with dirty materials, radioactive materials.
Yeah, it's interesting. Just this morning, they were talking about a jet that ISIS was talking about using as a suicide bomb. I don't know. It's a little, because we have this nice ocean between us and this sort of thing, that Americans have to wake up and recognize that
yes,
we have a real threat here.
Yes, we do.
Wow.
It's very serious. Wow.
What happened in Paris? How could this happen? We're told that they have the best security. Do they have a better infrastructure for defending their own country than we do?
No, not any better.
I didn't think so.
You know, their borders were wide open because of the Schengen Agreement, which basically says you don't need a passport to go from one country to another. So there's a flow of people back and forth. That Syrian that was in that group, you know, he came and went to Syria, and apparently they didn't know in Paris that this happened. They do have a lot of police. They have a lot of surveillance cameras. They have reasonably good intelligence, but it failed. It totally failed. You know, when you talk about 6 targets simultaneously, they had practiced maybe a couple targets simultaneously, but 6 just, you know, blew their minds in terms of security. You know, in America, you know, we've done similar things. We've increased threefold our intelligence investment. We've increased a host of other things, certainly made our borders tighter. You know, our no-fly list. It was only 12 or 19 back in 2001. Today, it's 48,000 and growing. You know, the vulnerability that we have, though, and most of the non-American jihadists that have come here have come through the visa program. The visa program allowed the shoe bomber to come in, allowed the underwear bomber to come in, and allows a lot of people. In fact, in countries like Germany, known about 5,000 jihadists that could get on an airplane today and not be stopped because of our visa program and come to America and do something. We have some evidence that has happened in the past. We need to get really serious about this. In fact, the Canadians, you know, interestingly, they said they're going to welcome 25,000 Syrians very shortly. You know, our president says 10,000, which is far too many, but they're talking about 25,000. And given the porous border we have with Canada, you know, you have to wonder, how many people are going to come south? And we already have a problem with people coming north. Just the other day, we stopped 9 trying to come into our southern border and then 5 down in Honduras. So there is a very serious border issue.
I hear every day on the news our leaders saying there is no problem. We have no evidence. You'll hear one person say there's no evidence that there's anyone inside of our country or anyone planning anything. Yet in their magazines they say we plan to destroy America. The very first statement after Paris, what was it, Lori? You remember?
One of the first ones I heard was that they were coming for, of course, Washington, D.C., and they wanted to taste American blood because there was no, that was the best blood
but
that they could taste.
It's in the social media, it's everywhere. How can our leaders keep telling us there's no sign that there's any danger in America? Yet you're telling me ISIS is in America.
They're lying to you.
Now, is it just you that says that they're lying to us, or is there other people with you at the Pentagon that understand that the lies that take place?
Well, if you'd listen to the former director of the Defense Intelligence Agency, he was on Fox last night, and I know him. He said, look, we've been telling the White House for years that this is a growing threat. Even Dianne Feinstein, who is no Republican,
yeah.
You know, she said on the news the other day that she reads the intelligence every day and
says
the problem is growing. It's getting much worse. You know, what they want to do, they're changing the dynamics of how they conduct operations. They use homegrown terrorists, but then they use some of these returning jihadists that have the killing skills, and then they have the general operation out of overseas, out of Syria or elsewhere. And so those three coming together is a very volatile mix, and that's what happened in Paris. They were able to, in a very sophisticated fashion, hit 6 targets simultaneously for about $2,000 investment. They made the suicide bombs out of hydrogen peroxide, which is the same problem we've had in this country, and that's the reason you can't take fluids on.
Welcome to the Jim Baker Show, coming to you from the village of Morningside, snuggled in the beautiful Ozark Mountains. Today, Jim's special guest, Lieutenant Colonel Robert McGinnis, Tom Horn. I'm Zach Drew, along with the Morningside Band. And now, direct from Gray Street at Morningside, here are your hosts, Jim and Lori Baker.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to Gray Street.
Hi there.
So grateful to have you at our house today.
We are.
And we have an amazing broadcast. You do not want to miss this show.
That's right.
We have the final Pope author here with us today.
That's right. Yes.
Thomas Horn is back.
You're a
great guest.
Yeah.
And you brought a special friend with you today. I just got his book last night.
I'm amazing.
A speed reader, but not that fast. I was racing through this book.
Really? Truly.
I want to tell you, this book, Never Submit, is perhaps one of the most important books you'll ever read.
It's America's time to read this book.
That's right.
Now.
Yes.
Now. Lieutenant Colonel Robert McManus is here with us today from the Pentagon. He is a senior strategist at the Pentagon. Worked there. How long have you been in and out of the Pentagon? Have you been in different positions there? I know over the years.
I started in 69 at West Point, and I'm still at the Pentagon. So there a couple years in between. So it's over 40 years.
Wow. Wow. So you work for the Department of the Army. You worked as Inspector General at the Pentagon. What else did you do? Could you give me a little more of your background?
Well, right. I'm a combat officer, an infantry officer,
wow.
a ranger. I served in four infantry divisions. Have been, most recently, I run a course for the Army that trains people how to do engagements with armies across the world. I actually train officers and senior civilians on how to do that. And in fact, I'm just about ready to go to Europe to do another one. And then I do a lot of media on the side because I've been an analyst for the last couple of decades.
You're really called upon by the media. I know you're on CNN, you're on Fox.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, we see you. And
yes.
Newspapers, New York Times, U.S. News World Report, Time Magazine. You have written 235 reports on ISIS. So if there's anybody I want to interview today,
yes.
Who is ISIS? What are they doing? What mm-hmm. in the world is going on in our world today?
That's right.
Didn't you report 9/11? And on Fox News or something?
Yeah, I was with several times that day. The last with Bill Bennett and O'Reilly from 11 to 12 o'clock that night. And I had predicted...
That very day,
because I was right there. And I had predicted long before that Osama bin Laden was a threat to the United States because I covered what had happened in Tanzania and Uganda when they attacked our embassies. And also, curiosity as to what was happening with this jihadist movement and what it meant for the United States.
I'm going to really want to ask you a few questions about Paris. It's like, how could this happen to Paris? How does your book, this book, Never Submit? And I'm telling you, people, I've just gotten this book. And we'll go into it a little bit more as we go along today. But you can order the book through our show. Get it now and read it.
Yes.
Read it. You don't know where truth is anymore. You need to study. The Bible says study to show
right.
yourself approved.
Amen.
We
Amen.
Need to find out truth because we're
Amen.
In deep, deep, deep trouble.
That's right. Ain't no... One of the things that I'm excited about of having Lieutenant Colonel Robert McManus here today is that he has all of this seemingly, inside information, and even being at the Pentagon and being able to filter through what we're seeing on the media and be able to talk to us about the real truth about what's going on. Because even though he's, hardcore in the government, knows this information, he filters it all through a biblical worldview.
Yes. Yeah, thank you, Lord.
Tom, tell us how you met.
Well, actually, we have a mutual friend, Terry James, who is a blind conservative Baptist writer. I've published a lot of books. I think Terry's got 40 or 50 books out there now that's been published over the years. And I knew him, and he came to me one day, and he said, hey, would you be interested in publishing a book? Because he knew that Joel Richardson and I are friends, and that Joel and I had talked quite a bit, and you've had Joel on the program,
yes.
about the whole apocalyptic mindset
yes.
behind ISIS, which was
yes.
important to me. And Terry said, how would you like to publish a guy that works at the Pentagon, who happens to agree with this apocalyptic mindset, but who has an insider's, a plan, really, for how to defeat the Islamic State, and this from a guy that this is what he does. He teaches people how to make war, right? And yet, he's a prophecy believer. I'm like, wow, really? I mean, this is a lot of good stuff all rolled into one.
It sure is.
And not just a Christian, a conservative Christian.
Yeah.
Because today,
Amen.
Christianity can mean anything, right?
Sure can.
Yeah.
Sure
wow,
can.
That's, so I jumped at the chance, yeah.
That's
yeah.
shocking that you're a conservative Christian. The this there's such a warfare. America has changed in the last, really, decade, a couple decades of extreme change. But it's like God has been outlawed, and every other ism has been allowed in. I'm scared for America. I really am. I love America. And I believe America is in deep, deep trouble. What do you see from inside the Pentagon?
Well, I agree with you, Pastor. And in fact, the American people do as well. A new poll says about 83% have no confidence in.
How many?
83%.
83% have no confidence?
Confidence in the direction that we're going with regard to terrorism.
Does anybody hear?
That's right. That's right.
Are you all listening to me?
Yes.
No, I mean, why is nobody listening, but yet everybody's saying the same thing?
Well, they are. You know, as we look around the landscape of the world, we see wars throughout the Middle East. It's just imploding. We see the Europe that we used to think was stable is really beset by terrorism. Russia is loose. The Chinese are becoming very adversarial. There's not a safe place in the world, to include our own borders, which are porous and wide open to jihadists, and we have plenty of reports there. So you look around the world, and you can't help but believe that, you know, if you're a believer in 1 Timothy 3, you see all of that happening in the culture. You believe in Zechariah, you see, you know, Israel is the target. And so as I look geopolitically at what's happening in the world, I look at it through that lens and understand that we are perhaps treading ever closer to an end time scenario. And interestingly, the ISIS people, the Islamists, they say that in their own writings. So, you know, I look at Dabiq, which of course is their, you know, their glossy magazine. And just this past week, I was looking at it. And they have, they talk about the end times. They talk about hating everybody but them. And their own particular slice of Islam, which is rather conservative, to say the least. And I look at what our president is doing. It seems like he's running in opposite direction that the American people want us to go.
Yes.
You know, we feel abandoned in terms of our own personal security. And that's why the polls are beginning to reflect what the American people believe. Yeah. And that is that this man is not looking out for our best interests.
No.
And that's unfortunate, because we need a commander-in-chief.
That's right. There it is. There it is.
And I think as Christians, we're told to respect our leaders. We're told to pray for our leaders.
Yes.
And, I mean, we need to pray for our president like we've never prayed before.
Amen.
But it's so heartbreaking, because America is really divided. But yet more and more, they're screaming out. They're worried about Paris. Can we talk a little bit about Paris today and what's happened over in Paris? And then in Belgium, Brussels is an amazing city. Have you ever been there? It's a beautiful city. I flew there from India one time, from the worst floods in history. And then I land at this beautiful, shiny airport in Brussels. And it was such a contrast. And they've closed, as we're taping this program, they have been closed. The city has been closed for days. What in the, come on now. There's got to be more that they know that they're not telling us, to close down Brussels, Belgium, to Brussels in Belgium, to close it all down.
That's
for
right.
Weeks now almost. It's going into a second week, I think.
Yeah, well, the article right here, it says, Brussels will remain at the highest possible alert level. It says, with schools, universities, and metros closed over a serious
because they've lost control of their culture. You know, you've had, for instance, in Brussels or in Belgium, you've had about 700 people that have gone to Syria, learned how to kill, and many have come back. In France alone, you had 1,800 that have gone to Syria. You know, 180 have come back, and there are a bunch of them that are still loose. You also have within those countries, you know, I call it a Dalmatian effect. You have in the industrial areas of Lyon and Paris and Marseille, these ghettos of people that have come in there as legal refugees, but they failed to totally assimilate. That's important because when ISIS comes in and recruits, they recruit amongst the dissatisfied people, the people that want a different purpose, that don't like the West. And so they raised up five of those killers the other night in Paris. Were all French nationals. And of course, the ringleader appears to have been a Frenchman who was in Syria, who was controlling things from Raqqa. So you've got this happening across Europe. It's been going on for a couple of decades, and it's getting very, very bad.
You say it's been going on for several decades. When I read Joel's book,
Joel Richardson's book, yes.
I mean, it was such a shock to my system.
Right.
I didn't put it down like your
right.
book.
Yes.
I got my hands on it, and I had to go to sleep because I have to do a show, and you get old, you got to sleep once in a while. But I read Joel's. You read
yeah.
it too.
Oh, it was.
And it was shocking.
If you haven't read it, you need to read this too.
What I thought was coming someday is already here. We've been infiltrated. You know, the communists used to have an agenda that they said they would destroy America from within. And it looks like it's not the communists, but it looks like there's another group that's here already. Do you think even ISIS is inside of our country?
Oh, of course. There are 1,000 investigations the FBI is doing right now. We have the likes of the Muslim Brotherhood who's made it very clear their intent is to take over as much as they can. You know, I talked to a gentleman the other day who has interviewed hundreds of Al-Qaeda and Islamists in the Middle East. And he said, Bob, you know, they don't just want to kill us. They want to take over our children. What they want to do is come in and take over the schools. And if you look at the investment of the radical Saudi Arabian government, they're in our prisons. They're in our schools. They run the teachers' colleges, in many cases, through their endowments and the like. This is what they're thinking long term. So we have to recognize that, yes, we have a very serious terrorist threat. We have ISIS amongst us. My own son-in-law, a sergeant in our local police department, went into a home. The parents didn't know. The son had an ISIS flag on the wall. He had been recruiting for ISIS and sent some of his friends to Syria. That's